Good afternoon, students. Welcome to the live lecture of functional analysis. In the last lecture, we have seen the proof of completeness of the quotient norm spaces. Before that, let me just tell you what is the statement of our theorem. X be a nonlinear space, M be the closed subspace of the given nonlinear space X defined, and we were defining norm 1 on the quotient space X by M to R by norm 1 of X plus M defined to be inferior. Norm of x plus m such that m belongs to m. We wanted to prove that this norm 1 is a norm on the quotient space. Also, if x is given to be a Banach space, then this quotient norm space is also a Banach space. Here is the diagram. I told you how to execute that norm. Okay. Later we have started the proof for proving norm 1 is a norm. We have verified step by step all the four conditions of norm definition, and we have proved that this norm 1 is the norm on the quotient space X by M. Later, for the second step, we have started with an assumption that X is a Banach space, and our aim is to prove that this quotient norm space is a Banach space. Now, actually, to prove Banach space, already we have proved this is a nonlinear space. So, what condition remains to prove? Completeness, right? Now, to prove the completeness property of the quotient norm spaces, we were starting with one Cauchy sequence in the quotient norm space. But as of we know that this Cauchy sequence or the elements of this Cauchy sequence are the sets. Okay. Therefore, to prove the convergence of this Cauchy sequence, we were trying to extract a convergence subsequence from this Cauchy sequence, right? And we know if the sequence has a convergence subsequence, this sequence is also convergent. This Sn plus m is a Cauchy sequence, and by using the definition of this Cauchy sequence property, we have fixed out some values or some stages n1, n2, and after fixing those stages for the different values of epsilon, such that epsilon is half, epsilon is half square, and so on, we have extracted one Cauchy sequence, rather a sequence I tell, that xn, xk plus n is the sequence, right? Very please, I have written here. Xk plus m is the subsequence of sn plus m we have obtained, which satisfies this condition, right? Our aim is to prove that this subsequence is convergent. Again, the elements of this subsequence are the sets, right? This is the original sequence, Sn plus M. This is extracted subsequence, Xk plus M. Again, the elements are sets. Now, for the sake of proving the result, we will try to take one element of every set. Here I have shown you in detail. Then, the sequence will be constructed of elements or scalars or coincidences. Then the aim is to prove that the sequence is Cauchy and then convergent. And using this, we can prove that this Xn plus M sequence is convergent. Right? And this is the in-detail stepwise method I explained earlier. So without wasting the time on this, I will just come to the next theorem. Whether anyone is having a doubt in the proof of this, I assume that you have recalled the proof of this one. Yes? Should I go for the next one now? Next theorem.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, in the next example, we were going to prove an important property that whenever a nonlinear space is with us, suppose some X is a nonlinear space, right? Suppose this is X is a nonlinear space, or I write Banach space directly as a Banach space. And if I consider one closed sphere, say yes, okay. How we were writing the definition for the closed sphere? Collection of the element x in x such that. Now the distance we were counting or measuring by norm, therefore shall I write norm x less than or equals to 1. But what kind of sphere I am considering? Is it closed sphere?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, the next example we were going to prove that X is Banach space if and only if S is complete. Okay. Or one can say that X is complete if and only S is complete. That is, completeness of this Banach space or this space X depends on the completeness of the sphere. We have one small sphere in the given vector space or the linear space, then we can say that the whole no linear space is also complete. This is one of the important and major example we were going to do. Let me write the statement. Let X be a non-linear space and yes, be defined to be collection of all elements X in X such that norm X is less than or equals to 1. B, a subspace of X. Be a subspace of X. Then show that X is Banach space if and only if S is complete. S is complete, or you can write S is Banach, because a subspace of a non-linear space will be non-linear space under the same norm, right? No? Therefore, one can say that this completeness property was implies an implied. X is complete implies an implied, right? This subspace S is also complete. Okay. Let us go for the proof of this one. Proof is very easy. As it is ether only statement, let us prove this into two parts. In the first part, what I will assume, which part you feel easy to prove? Yes. Which part should I assume first? X Banach space, then proving S complete, or reverse? Which you feel easy? X is bigger space, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Which one you feel easy to prove?
X Banach space, yes, it's complete.
Right. Let us assume both parts are actually easy, but this one is more easy. Therefore, let me assume first that X is Banach space. X is a Banach space. And what will be the aim to prove? S is complete. Right. So what is the meaning to prove S is complete again? We have to start with one Cauchy sequence and we will prove the sequence is converging to some element in the same space, right? Let me start with, let some Xn be a sequence and consider it. Let Xn be a Cauchy sequence in S, right? If it is Cauchy in S, may I say it is Cauchy in X also? Here it is a sequence, Xn. If it is a sequence in S, it is a sequence in X. If it is a Cauchy in S, it is Cauchy in X as well, right? So may I say this implies the sequence Xn is Cauchy sequence in X. Okay, but what is my assumption? X is?
Banach space.
Banach space. For this Cauchy is convergent. Therefore, here right, as X is Banach space, as X is Banach space, this sequence Xn is convergent in capital X.
Yes,
that is, say sequence Xn converges to X in capital X. Converges to some point in the same space. Okay. Can I write in the limit form? That is limit n tends to infinity. Yes, how can I write? May I write norm of xn minus x is equal to 0. In real analysis, we were writing mod xn minus x, no? We were writing like this, no? Mod of xn minus x tends to 0, right? But now this mod we were replacing by norm, because the distance measuring function we were using as norm. Correct, now? If the limit norm xn minus x is tending to 0, or limit is equal to 0. Now let me use one fact that norm is a continuous function. Correct, now? We know that norm is a continuous function, right? As norm is a continuous function, as xn tends to x in x, may I say it will imply norm xn tends to norm of x in which space it is now?
Yes,
I think this is the question I have asked you. If x n tends to x, if f is continuous, then f of x n tends to f of x. I want the reason for this. We have studied this theorem actually. Okay. Therefore, in which space this element will be in R max? What is the codomain for your norm function?
Real.
Yes, it is. Therefore, can I write this is in R? Right?
Yes, ma'am.
Norm x n tends to norm of x. Actually, our job is to show that this x is in S, right? No? Is in S. Because once this limit point is in S, it is a Cauchy sequence converging to a point in S. Then S will be complete, right? So to show x is in S, what condition it should satisfy? Norm x less than or equals to 1. Correct now? Now we were trying to have an approach norm x less than or equals to 1. Now norm x n less tends to norm of x in R. Okay. Now I will write as x n is in S. What about norm of x n? Is it less than or equals to n? 1.
Yes, ma'am.
Or all n, because these are the elements. Okay. Now, if norm xn is less than or equals to 1, what about limit n tends to infinity norm xn? This is also less than or equals to 1. Now, there is no n on the right. Therefore, let me take n tends to infinity on both the sides. Okay. But what is limit n tends to infinity here? Norm x n tends to?
Norm x.
I can write here as n tends to infinity. Here also as n tends to infinity. Right now? Therefore, here can I write this is norm x. And which is less than or equals to 1. If norm x is less than or equals to 1, may I say the element x is in S now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thus, we get a Cauchy sequence. What we get? A Cauchy sequence xn in S is convergent to a point x in S. Therefore, may I say S is complete? Hence, S is complete. Therefore, which theorem is helpful for proving this part? Norm is a continuous function. Everything depends on this, no? Norm is a continuous function. Let us go for the reverse part of the proof. Let me assume S is complete and the job is to prove that X is Banach. Let us assume S is complete. And what is my job to show? X is Banach space. In order to prove X is Banach space, already it is non-linear space given. X be a non-linear space. No? Therefore, may I say it is sufficient to prove, or it is enough to prove that? Enough to prove that X is complete. Right now? Now, in order to prove X is complete, again, I will start with one Cauchy sequence in X. Now, whether that Cauchy sequence will be a Cauchy sequence in S automatically? Now, here is the situation. If I am considering, say, Xn be a sequence in X now, whether it will be a Cauchy sequence in S automatically? Yes or no? Because in the earlier part of the proof, we have written this, no?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Now, we cannot say that the sequence xn Cauchy in X will be Cauchy in S, right? Therefore, we have to we have to impose this, we have to check this condition. Now, if I am considering the sequence xn in x, then how can we convert it to a sequence in s? Actually, we want the vectors to be unit vectors, no? Norm of the vectors is either unit or less than unity. Therefore, how can I convert any arbitrary vector xn to unit or less than unit? Can I write? Can I divide it by its mod, modulus? Then it will
yes,
be converted to unity, right now? Mod of xn upon mod of xn is 1. But now in this non-linear spaces, instead of modulus, we were using norm. Therefore, whatever the sequence we have selected in x, we will convert it to a sequence in s by dividing with its norm value, right? Okay. Sequence xn b in Cauchy sequence. In x, right? Now I will define a new sequence, say yn, right? And I will define this as xn upon norm of x, provided xn is non-zero vector, right now? Because for zero vector, no need to convert. It will be automatically a member of S. It will be automatically a member of S because its norm is less than or equals to 1. Now, if I do this, what is the value of norm? Let us check, consider. What is the norm value, norm yn? This is norm of xn upon norm of xn. Correct, na? Okay. Now, which is the scalar so that I can take it outside? Among these two, which one is scalar? Because now we were using this property, no? Norm of alpha x is mod of alpha into norm of x, right? Which is the scalar value so that I can take it outside? Hello, Sujit.
Yes, ma'am.
Xn is a vector. What about norm of xn? Vector or a scalar? Norm is a function defined from x to
scalar, ma'am.
Yes, this is a vector space. Elements in R are scalars, right? Therefore, among these two, which one is scalar? Norm xn is
norm
scalar.
Xn.
Therefore, let us take this 1 upon norm of xn outside the norm with modulus, right? What is remaining with us then? Norm of xn only. But is there any meaning to write the norm in the modulus? Because modulus makes the value non-negative. Already we have norm xn to be a non-negative value. Therefore, no need to write that modulus only. Or you can write the value is same. But what is the value we were getting? Is it 1?
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, dividing the vector by its norm, the vector converted to unit vector. Right, ma'am? Therefore, now may I say this sequence, a new sequence yn we have constructed, is a sequence in S. Can we say directly Cauchy in S? No. It is simply a sequence in S. Now our job is to check whether it is Cauchy. Or rather, the job is to prove that this sequence yn is Cauchy. So what is my claim? Sequence yn is Cauchy in S. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
First we have said that sequence is in S. Now we were claiming Cauchy in S. Why? Because we know S is complete. Okay. Once this sequence will be Cauchy in S, it will converge to some point Y in S. No. But this S is a subspace of X. Therefore, this Y will be in X automatically. Right, ma'am? Now,
yes, ma'am.
We will prove that the sequence yn is Cauchy by using xn is Cauchy. So let me consider norm of yn minus ym. What is yn we have as per the construction? This is xn upon norm of xn minus xm upon norm of xn. Right? Now, for the sake of proving the result, we were making some adjustment. We were adding and subtracting one term for the sake of proving the result. We were adding and subtracting the term xn upon norm of xn. Subtracted and added. Minus this last term xn upon norm of xm as it is. Okay. Now let us make some simplifications. First, what I will, I'll combine the first two terms and third and fourth term together. Let us separate it by using a triangular inequality. Therefore, may I say this equality becomes less than or equals to, right? Xn I will take common. V remains with 1 upon norm of xn minus 1 upon norm of xm. Added with. Here what can I take common? 1 upon norm of xm I can take common. And in bracket we remain with xn minus xn. Right? Now again, among these two, which one is scalar so that I can take it out with modulus? Clearly a term with norm will be a scalar value. Therefore this norm xn scalar, norm xn is also scalar. What about 1 upon norm xn scalar? What about the subtraction scalar? Therefore, let me take this out with the modulus right now. I hope I am clearly audible.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Now, what remains in the bracket? Norm of xn only. Right? Now, similarly, among these two, this one is scalar. Therefore, let me take it out with norm. Sorry, with modulus. And we remain with norm of xn minus xm. Okay. Now let us just make some simplification, some cross multiplication I will follow here. And we will get norm xm minus norm xn divided by norm xn into norm xm as it is. Everything will be in the modulus. Actually, no need to write the modulus for the denominator, right? No? Shall I write it for the numerator only?
Yes, ma'am.
Into norm xn added with. Here also there is no need to write a modulus because norm is always a non-negative quantity. Okay, let me cancel one norm xn and let me rewrite the terms. For V remains with only norm xm, and here also we have norm of xn minus xm divided by norm of xm. Now I am going to make use of one statement which we have proved in the earlier part of the lectures. Right? I don't know whether you are remembering or not. Let me just write. We have proved one result, modulus norm xn minus norm xm, we have proved less than or equals to norm of, so let me write the same symbols, x, y are the symbols we have used, norm x minus norm y less than or equals to norm of x minus y. This we have proved, no? This inequality,
yes,
we have proved. So using this, what is the relation here? Can I write simply norm of xn, xm minus xn divided by norm xm added with same term norm of xn minus xn divided by norm of xn. Now may I say both the numerators are same? Because here I can change their positions. Negative 1 will be taken out with the modulus, which will be positive one, right? Therefore, here I have two same terms. Therefore, I will write 2 times norm of xn minus xm divided by norm of, so to the left I have norm of y minus yn, I think, no? Yes, yn I have. Yn minus y. Okay. Now the fact is known to us that xn is assumed to be Cauchy. Therefore, what about this right hand side if mn tends to infinity? Right, this tends to zero as mn tends to infinity according to the property of the Cauchy sequences, right now? So this sequence yn minus yn will also tends to zero as mn tends to infinity. Therefore, what we have proved? Yn is Cauchy in. Cauchy sequence in. Yes, we have proved. But yes is complete. Right now? Here I forgot.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the reason here? Sequence xn is Cauchy. Now let us come to the next. This shows S is a Cauchy sequence in S, but, or I can write as S is complete. As S is complete, the sequence Yn converges to, say, Y in S. Converges to Y in S. Okay, that is Yn converges to Y as n tends to infinity. But what is yn we have constructed is of this type, na? Xn upon norm of xn. Converges to y as n tends to infinity. But our aim is to prove that xn is convergent. Therefore, as norm xn is a fixed scalar for every n, may I write xn converges to y into norm of xn? Now, what remains to check? For every value of n, this norm xn gives me a fixed scalar. Therefore, we have to check what is the limit point of this sequence norm of xn. And for this, we were going to write norm xn. We were going to use this result again. Let me use this result again. Now, I call this a statement 1, say now. May I write again norm xn minus norm xn less than or equals to norm of xn minus xn. But this xn minus xn, this will tends to 0 as mn tends to infinity. Reason? Sequence xn is Cauchy. Right now? Therefore, what about this term? Right hand side is tending to 0. What about left hand side? This will also tends to 0, no? Therefore, may I say, the sequence norm xn is Cauchy in. In what? May I write in R? But R is complete. But what about this sequence? This sequence norm of xn must be convergent in R. Now, for the sake of convenience, let me assume some limit of this sequence, that is norm xn, say converges to fixed scalar k in R, and let me call it as statement number 2. Right? This is statement number 2. Now, let us combine 1 and 2. This norm xn converges to k, therefore xn converges to ky, correct? From 1 and 2, here it, the sequence xn converges to ky in x. If y is in S, correct now, y is in S, what about ky? May I write it in x also?
Yes, ma'am.
Y is in S, therefore surely y is in x. And X is a vector space or the linear space closed under scalar multiplication. Therefore, ky is in X. Therefore, xn converges to some element in X itself. That's what we have proved. Hence, X is under it. Check if you have any doubt on this proof. That's it. This is my answer. Okay. First part of the proof is easy actually. Let me just recall in a few minutes. In the first part, assuming the bigger space X is bana, it's somewhat easier for us to prove that the subspace S is complete, because the sequence which is Cauchy in X will be Cauchy, the sequence which is Cauchy in S will be Cauchy in X. X is complete, therefore it will be convergent and it will be true. And we have used one of the results, now one is continuous function. But in the later part, assuming S is complete, to prove X is complete, a sequence, Cauchy sequence in X, we have to convert it to a Cauchy sequence in S. For that, we have divided every element of a sequence with its norm so that it will be a unit vector. Okay. Then it will be a sequence in S. Later we have proved it will be Cauchy in S, knowing the fact Xn is Cauchy. Once we get Yn is Cauchy, it will be convergent, converges to say Y in S. Therefore, if I replace Yn by Xn upon norm of Xn, it will give you Xn converges to Y upon norm of Xn. And then we have proved norm of Xn, as it is a Cauchy sequence in R, it will be converging to some scalar, say K. Therefore, Xn converges to Ky, and no doubt Ky is in X. That's why Xn, the Cauchy sequence Xn is converging to some point in X, hence X is complete, and proving this is Banach. Yes, students, if you have any difficulty till this, you can ask. Yes, if not, let us go for a next definition, direct sum of two subspaces. Have you heard this previously, direct sum of two subspaces? What is direct sum? I think you are familiar with this kind of symbol. X is equal to A direct sum B. Have you seen the symbol previously?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Then what is the structure of the elements in X? Every element in X can be written as the addition, rather a unique type of addition, say A plus B, where A is in A, B is in B. Right now?
Yes, ma'am.
And this representation of the element X in capital X is unit. Let me write a linear space X is said to be the direct sum of two subspaces X1 and X2 if every vector X in X is expressible as expressible uniquely as the sum X equal to x1 plus x2, where small x1 is in capital X1 and small x2 is in capital X2, and we write this as X is equal to x1 direct sum x2. Okay, and as we are writing this is uniquely, okay, every representation is unique. That is, you cannot write a vector. There are two different combinations for the vector X. Is that okay? Now the job is to define one norm on this direct sum and to show that this is the Banach space. And this is our example number 2. Previous one is example number 1, no? Now let me write example number 2. Suppose that a Banach space B is direct sum of linear space spaces m and n, that is V I am writing m direct sum n. Let z equal to x plus y be the unique representation of the vector z in V, where x is in M and y is in N. Now, what is the job we are doing? Define the function norm 1 on capital V y. What is y? This is norm 1 now. Z equal to norm x plus norm of y. Then show that. What we wanted to show? Two points to show. Norm 1 is a norm on B. Secondly, B norm 1 is a Banach space if M and N are closed subspaces. Closed subspaces of B. Okay, don't get confused, because here actually B started with a Banach space, and then again we wanted to prove B is a Banach space. Okay, actually whatever the B is a Banach space given initially, this is B with the this norm, simple norm. Okay, this norm symbol used, and then we were defining another norm, that is norm 1 on B, this norm, which is defined by this definition, right? And then we want to prove under this norm 1 also B is a Banach space. Before that, we will prove that this norm 1 is a norm on B. Okay. Whatever is this norm acting on B, as M and N are the subspaces, the same norm will work on the subspaces as well. Right now? So this was B initially given to us. These are the two subspaces, M and N. Initially, B norm is a Banach space. Therefore, what is the norm acting on the two spaces? Simple norm, right? No, without any dashes. These are the norms defined on M and N. Now, on the same space B, we were trying to define another norm. What is the norm we were trying to define? Norm 1 is the another norm we were defining. And at this norm, we have to prove that this B is a Banach. This is the aim to be, right? Now, what is the norm defined? Let us check. For an element z in B, what is the representation? Z written as x plus y, where x is in M, y is in N. But already on this M and N, norm is working. So how can we find out the distances or the length of these two vectors, x and y? By norm x and norm y, right now? Here I will write, this norm 1 is a norm on B. This is given. Okay. This is given. And what we wanted to prove, this norm 1 is a norm on B. This is we want to prove. That is my claim. Okay. Getting me? And this norm 1 is defined as whatever Z we have written X plus Y, we have to just make the addition, norm X and norm Y separate. This is also one kind of norm. This is also one of the way to find out the length of the vector z in B, where B is the direct sum of the two subspaces, M and N. Okay, let us go for the first step to prove that norm 1 is a norm on B. What is our job? Verify four conditions, right? Step 1. To prove that norm 1 is a norm on B. Okay, what is the first condition to prove then?
Norm
1 of Z is non-negative. Very good. Okay. But consider, what is Z given to us? X plus Y, right? Now, X is in M, Y is in N. How this norm 1 of Z is defined? This is norm X plus norm of Y. But what about these two norms? This is already a norm given on B, right? Therefore, may I say both are non-negative? But norm X is non-negative, norm Y is non-negative. Reason is norm is a norm on B. Means we are dealing with two norms on this. One is this norm, and which is given to be a norm, and another is normal, which we wanted to be a norm on B, right? Therefore, if norm X is non-negative, norm Y is non-negative, what about the addition of two non-negatives?
Non-negative.
May I say norm 1 of Z is non-negative? Okay. Second point to prove. What we wanted to prove? Norm 1 of Z is equal to 0 implies and implied by Z is equal to. Consider. Norm 1 of Z implies and implied by. How this norm 1 of Z is defined? Norm X plus norm Y is equal to 0. But as these two norms are non-negative values, where the addition is equal to 0, then this is possible?
When both are 0.
When both norms are 0. Very good. Norm X is 0, norm Y is 0. But already these two are the norms defined on B. Because using the second condition, norm X equal to 0, may I write X is equal to 0? Similarly, Y is equal to 0. Like what about Z?
Equals to
Z is equal to 0. Because we have proved norm 1 of Z is equal to 0 implies and implied by Z is equal to 0. Third, we wanted to prove triangular equality, na? Let me write Z1 plus Z2, norm 1 of Z1 plus Z2, and we wanted to prove that this is norm 1 of Z1 added with norm 1 of Z2. Okay, where? What I have defined Z1? What I will define? See, I will define it as X1 plus Y1. Z2 I will define as X2 plus Y2 on the condition. What about X1 and X2? Is in?
M.
Y1, Y2 in? N.
N.
Okay. Now let us consider the left hand side. What is the left hand side? Consider. Norm 1 of Z1 plus Z2. Okay. Let me write the value. This is X1 plus Y1 added with X2 plus Y2 in norm 1. If we look at this norm definition very carefully, what is done while defining a norm? Z is actually X plus Y. X is in M, Y is in N. Only the thing is taken, elements of M taken separately, elements of N taken separately, and separate norms were utilized, or separate norms were formed, and addition was done. Now we will do the same job. We will identify the elements in M, identify the elements in N, we will just separate, right? If I may say X1, X2 are the elements in M, what about X1 plus X2 then?
In M.
Right. Similarly, Y1 plus Y2 is in M. Then how can I use this norm 1 definition? Use this norm 1 definition and tell me.
Norm of X1 plus X2 plus norm of Y1 plus Y2.
Very good. Norms we are separating simply. Reason X1 plus X2 is an element of M. Y1 plus Y2 is an element of n and my definition of norm 1, right? But already these are the norms depend on the Banach space, right? Now, therefore, may I use triangular equality? Right now, can we use triangular inequality for this? Yes, we can use. Therefore, I'll write norm x1 plus norm x2 added with norm y1 plus norm y2. Now, we will try to combine this because the aim is to prove the term is norm 1 of z1. What do you think norm 1 of z1 will be? Norm x1 plus norm y1, no? Addition.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, let us combine the elements accordingly. Right? x1, y1 I have combined. Let me combine x2, y2 as well. And according to the definition, may I say this is nothing but norm 1 of z1 and this is norm 1 of z2. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Hence, we have proved the triangular inequality also. Now, let us come to the fourth point to prove norm 1 of alpha z equal to mod alpha into norm 1 of z. Consider norm 1 of alpha z, right now? What is z we have? X plus y, no? Correct, na? X is in m, y is in n. Let me multiply by the scalar alpha x and alpha y. If x is in m, what about alpha x?
M.
Is in m because it's a linear space closed under scalar multiplication. Alpha y is in. This is an element of m, this is an element of n. How can I use a norm 1 definition?
Norm of alpha x plus norm of alpha y.
Very good. Norm alpha x plus norm alpha y. But already this is the norm defined in the Banach space. Therefore, can I use the fourth condition?
Yes, ma'am.
Mod alpha into norm x plus norm y. Left we have norm 1 alpha z. Okay, what about this one? If z I am writing x plus y, what is this value norm x plus norm y?
Norm 1 of z.
Yes, it is norm 1 of z. Hence the proof. That is what we have proved. All four conditions are verified. Four conditions of norm 1 are verified. This implies norm 1 is a norm on B. Okay? First step we have verified. What to prove in the second step? B norm 1 is the Banach space. Therefore, we have proved just now that B norm 1 is a norm linear space. Correct, na? We can write B norm 1 is a normed linear space. Now, to prove this is Banach space, it remains to prove the completeness property only. Okay. Now, I will tell you the hint for the completeness property and I will leave the proof for you people, right? My aim is to prove that B norm 1 is a Banach space. May I say it is enough to prove? It is enough to prove B norm 1 is complete, right now? If I wanted to prove it is complete, what should I do? I will start with some sequence Zn, right now? The Cauchy sequence in B norm 1. If it is Cauchy sequence in B norm 1, what is the meaning? For every epsilon greater than 0, there exists a stage n such that, norm 1 of Zn minus Zm less than epsilon for all m, n greater than or equals to capital N, right? What is the definition of norm 1? Where Zn written as xn plus yn. Xn is in m, yn is in n. Okay? Right? If this norm 1 is less than epsilon, what about this definition? Xn plus yn. While using the definition, what one has to do? We have to separate the elements simply, na?
Yes, ma'am.
So let me just separate the elements of n. Let me take it in one bracket. Elements of n taken in one bracket. Now let us use this norm 1 definition. What is the norm 1 definition now? Is it norm xn minus xm added with norm yn minus ym less than epsilon, right? So if the sum of two non-negative terms is less than epsilon, what about the every value?
Less than epsilon.
Okay, if what we have obtained? Xn is a Cauchy sequence in M, yn is Cauchy sequence in N, right now?
Yes, ma'am.
This shows that xn is, if we complete, xn is Cauchy in M and sequence yn is Cauchy in N. But what are the two spaces given to us? These are the closed spaces given. Let us make use of the property of the closed spaces. As M and N are closed, may I say these are complete as well? Closed subspaces,
yes,
of the complete space are complete. We have proved already, right? So here I will write, as M and N are closed, it will implies M and N are complete spaces. Now if M and N are complete, what about these Cauchy sequences, Xn in M and Yn in M?
Converges in M and N.
Therefore, shall I write directly here? Hence, Xn converges to X in M as N tends to infinity. Yn converges to Y in N as N tends to infinity. Okay. Now, X is one element in M, Y is another element in N I have obtained. And now I will define Z to be X plus Y. Therefore, may I say Z is in B then. And what is my last aim now? Zn is a Cauchy sequence we have started with. And the aim is to show that this converges to Z. Therefore, I will make a last aim. Within 2 minutes, we will complete the proof that the claim is Zn converges to Z in B. How can I prove the convergence? I have to prove norm 1 of Zn minus 1 either less than epsilon or tends to 0, right now? This I have to prove either less than epsilon or tends to 0. Let me write the value. Zn I can write xn plus yn. Z is x plus y under norm 1. Again, we will use the same strategy, separate the elements of m and n. Now use norm 1 definition. Norm 1 definition says that this is norm of xn minus x plus norm of yn minus y. Okay. Now as xn converges to x, What about this norm value, norm xn minus x? May I write less than epsilon?
Yes, ma'am.
What about norm yn minus y? Less than epsilon. But we want to make the addition less than epsilon. Then what the adjustment I will do?
Epsilon by 2.
Yes, it is epsilon by 2. Less than epsilon by 2. And yn converges to y will give us norm of yn minus y less than epsilon by 2. Here I will put epsilon by 2 plus epsilon by 2, which is epsilon. That what we have proved? Norm 1 of zn minus z less than epsilon. Therefore, the sequence zn converges to z in B. Hence, may I write B norm 1 is complete. Yes? Any doubt with the proof?
No.
If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Very simple proof. Now, initially, all the four conditions we have verified. And to prove that B norm 1 is a Banach space, we have started with one Cauchy sequence. By using the Cauchy sequence property, we have obtained two sequences, Xn and Yn, Cauchy in respectively in M and N. But M and N are provided to be closed, because these are complete. As these are complete, the sequences are convergent. Taking the limit points, we will construct one point Z in B. Lastly, we will just show Zn converges to Z. This we have done. Okay? Here we will stop for today. If you have any difficulty, you can unmute yourself and ask. No difficulties? Okay, let me stop it here. Thank you for being with me for this lecture.